Hey guys, so I'm continuing to just kind of share what I wrote back to this back and forth email conversation I had with a Christian YouTube user. And this is my last reply to him. He hasn't responded back to this reply as of this time. So I'm just going to share what I wrote. This reply actually was kind of a more reputational, like refutation. I quoted him, and then I responded to those quotes. So it's kind of like a reputation. And I did that in a bunch of different sections. So when I quote him, I'll kind of try to speak differently, like, I'll be talking like this, you know, just to differentiate from what I wrote compared as in contrast to what he wrote. So the message kind of has its beginnings, but I'll get right to the meat of it. It starts kind of with his quote, and he said this: "Why do you think the designer was incompetent? Can you show me how the Bible contradicts the Big Bang?" And I think he also like tried to ask me like, "What books are you using? Like, and why do you trust that book more than the Bible?" Which was a weird question because I wasn't using any book; I was using the Bible. Anyway, this is what I wrote: Genesis chapter 1, bud. That's what I read. That's what I'm using. Read it carefully and look at modern findings on the field of astrophysics, cosmology, and geology. The Genesis creation myth does not fit at all with what modern science has shown to be true about the universe. As I mentioned to you before, Genesis says that God created light first. Let there be light. Though before light, actually, Bible also says that God was moving of the waters, or the spirit of the waters if you're reading King James Version. Whatever the hell that means. When the Big Bang occurred, light particles didn't even exist. And even after Big Bang, they still didn't exist. The concept of light is very Earth-centric as well. Genesis says that the sun and the moon exist to provide light to Earth. Sun during the day, moon during the night. But that makes absolutely no sense when considering the origin of the entire universe. There are trillions of other galaxies, each of which have their own suns and moons. They do not exist merely to provide light to planet Earth. That's ridiculous. Yet that's exactly what the Bible claims. God in the Bible separates the water from the land, but didn't he need to create the innermost molten layers of the planet before being able to do so? Because that's what land needs. How did he separate land from water without first creating that? The order of creation as told in the Bible, the details of the creation. To say that it doesn't contradict science is, I don't know, delusional? I urge you to study more science and also read the Bible clearly, like really read it, and then come back to me and try to tell me that the Bible does not contradict the Big Bang Theory, because it does. It contradicts not only the Big Bang Theory, but so many things in modern science. Footnote here, you know, I think my most recent videos on this channel of me reading the Bible is on Leviticus, right? And it starts talking about like how Israelites should handle skin diseases and how they should treat mildew in house and mildew in clothing. And if you look at the instructions on how to handle that, it's the most bizarre thing ever. Bible is so concerned with cleanliness and ceremonial cleanliness rather than being cured from the skin disease. Bible says if you have a skin disease, you don't go to a doctor, you go to a priest. What does the priest do? The priest doesn't diagnose you and give you medicine and treat you. No, the Bible says nothing of that kind. The Bible says priest sees you and either judges you as clean or unclean. If you're unclean, then you're supposed to be separated from the rest of the society for 7 days. And then you wait for 7 days. Then you see the priest again. And the priest will determine you clean or unclean, to see if your skin disease has progressed badly, or stayed the same, or been cured. I don't know why it would be just suddenly magically cured for waiting for 7 days, but sure. Okay. And then if the priest judges you unclean, then you are to like, there's like purification process of going into the, taking a bath 7 times, making a blood offering, and you know, chopping off the head of a pig or a bird and splashing the blood of that onto an altar, all that kind of stuff for skin disease. Do you see any hospitals doing that today? Hospitals use science. They don't use the Bible. To say that the Bible doesn't contradict science is... Anyway, that's my footnote. Let's continue on. This is also something he wrote. I'm quoting him now. Pretty much proven does not mean proven. You're right, I have not studied science, but I will for this argument. But as far as gravity and theory, if I drop a ball, it falls. Is that not gravity? That's what he says. This is what I wrote back in response. Nothing in science is 100% proven. But there are a number of things that are pretty much proven, evolution being one of them, and gravity being one of them, though less so. Now, we know gravity does occur. We know there's a force that pulls everyone and everything to the center of the planet's core. We do indeed call that gravity. But we also call gravity the force that puts Earth in orbit of the sun. How is it that gravity functions in a way that makes people of planet Earth attracted to the planet's core instead of magnetizing the people to the sun? Why do certain atoms that compose the universe stick together and certain others don't? We know that gravity is doing this, but no one at this point knows how. There have been many hypotheses about what makes gravity gravity, but it's been very hard for scientists to come up with valid proofs for those hypotheses. The theory of evolution, on the other hand, not only do we know that it occurs, but we also have a pretty good idea of how it occurs, and we have mountains and mountains of evidence supporting such ideas. And that's what I mean when I say that theory of evolution via natural selection, it's much more established and better proved than the theory of gravity currently. As far as the world around us, it is the product of a fallen world. It happened in Genesis. As a result of Adam's sins, the world is fallen. Things are not perfect. People suffer. The Bible tells this. This is my response. So, this is where your logic takes you in that case. God tells Adam and Eve not to eat from the tree of life and from the tree of knowledge. That's the only commandment God gives to Adam and Eve according to the Bible. Adam and Eve end up disobeying that command and eats from the tree of knowledge. Footnote, but not from the tree of life. End footnote. This is what Christians like you refer to as the original sin. According to your logic, it's this sin that results in, women suffering during childbirth, animals becoming carnivores when they all used to be vegetarian, certain plants becoming poisonous to human beings, genetic disorders such as Huntington's disease, hurricanes, and typhoons that kills a lot of people, etc., etc., etc. What you are essentially saying is that because two human beings thousands of years ago ate a piece of fruit, now the universe is fucked. Instead of God saying, hey, Adam and Eve, you disobeyed my command, here's a spanking. And that being it, God instead decides to change the universe in such a way that there's so much suffering. I realize you may consider this as a straw man argument, but think about it. This is basically what Christianity is saying, that the original sin of eating from the tree of knowledge without a deity's permission is the cause of the world being fallen. And what does the world being fallen mean? Immense, immense amount of suffering. All because somebody thousands of years ago ate a piece of fruit. That's where your logic takes you. Accept it or not, that is the logic of Christianity. As far as God killing people, these were wicked people. More wicked than you can imagine. Sure, some of the people that God murdered, I would agree that some of them were wicked. But are you really sure you want to argue that everyone that God of the Bible murdered were wicked? Read the second half of Exodus and the first few chapters of Leviticus. In those books, God kills two priests, by the way, not wicked people, two priests, because they made an offering over unsanctified fire, whatever the hell that means. God also kills someone for ejaculating semen outside of a woman's vagina. You know, that's almost like God killing someone for masturbation. Do you think masturbation is wicked enough to warrant capital punishment? Also, you talk a lot about God redeeming Israel from slavery and all that, but don't you realize what kind of favoritism that is? So God would redeem the people of Israel, but at the cost of slaughtering millions of people of other nationalities and other faith. Didn't God create all human beings? Why does she favor one group of wicked and sinful people over other groups of wicked and sinful people? Israel, even according to the Bible, was no more righteous than many other nations of his time. Yet God often eradicates people of other nations, often in one fell swoop. But he also kills a lot of Israelites as well, to his credit. There are times when he kills a group of Israelites because they touched the Ark of the Covenant improperly. For complaining to God that they don't have enough to eat, God gives those complaining Israelites a terrible, painful sickness, which ends up killing all of them. Just to win a bet against the devil, God kills off Job's first wife and children. Were Job's children really wicked? More wicked than I can imagine? As far as Jesus, no other Messiah figure came back from death. He did more than say nice things. He performed miracles. This statement, I think, is the most ignorant statement you have made to me thus far, because it demonstrates to me your lack of knowledge about other myths and other religions long before and after the advent of Christianity. Even some Native American religions feature Messiah figure that rose back from the dead and performed miracles. There is nothing unusual about Jesus' story, other than the fact that so many people today believe it as true, while they discount other similar myth and religious stories. Dawkins? He also says, mock people who believe in religion. I have no idea where you got that Dawkins said this. This is not at all what Dawkins says regarding religious people. He considers religious faith to be nothing more than a delusion, but it's not like he says, go out there and mock religious people. But even if he did say things like that, let me make a clarification. I did not quote Dawkins. And I'm not using him as a credible source. I'm just saying I merely said this is how he would answer this question. And it's how I answer the question of if people are naturally good or naturally evil. Lastly, regarding morality, again, you're demonstrating that you do not know how evolution via natural selection works. Contrary to popular notion, evolution via natural selection is not survival of the fittest. Especially recent scientific research has shown that evolution via natural selection requires cooperation within species, and oftentimes even cooperation among species, in order for those species to survive and thrive. Such cooperations require moral codes and ethics. And because the nature of cooperations are different among different species, different societies, hence different societies have varying moral codes. When you say there is an ultimate law and lawgiver, then of course, the inevitable question is, what is that law? Where do we get such ultimate law from? You answer God, and that the law is the Bible. Okay, so what kind of moral laws does the Bible have? Well, it says that having sex with a woman while she's on her period is morally wrong. So wrong, in fact, that the person who does it should be stoned to death. Not only that, anyone who fails to stone both the woman and the man to death must be punished also. Do you agree with this kind of moral law? If you said no, then you are essentially saying that morality does evolve and should evolve. If you said yes, then yikes, you either belong in a mental asylum or in prison. Now, I know the cop-out answer to this question is that the Old Testament laws are no longer relevant because Jesus came and rescued us from it. Right, well, if that's the case, then why are people being thrown into hell for not believing in Jesus? If Jesus' crucifixion matters, then the moral laws of the Old Testament matters as well, which states that if you have a skin disease and not wash your body 7 times, you're to be ostracized from the rest of society. It states that you could beat your slave as long as your slave doesn't die from the beating. It states that someone who practices witchcraft must be stoned to death. Think about those kind of laws. How can they be considered moral laws? Maybe at one point in human history, such laws were acceptable. But you and I can both agree that such laws are no longer acceptable. Hence, you and I see that morality evolves, that morality is relative to place and time. I think it's interesting that someone would argue for an absolute law and for an absolute lawgiver. Somebody could argue that. But if you're using the Bible as the evidence for that, then you're just flat out refusing to see how morality has actually evolved since the time of the Bible and continues to do so.